Hi, and welcome to Haunted AF, the podcast of real ghost stories told by real people. We are your hosts. I'm Julie Fisk.
And I'm Rebecca Black.
So coming up, we have multiple creepy whisper stories.
I love it.
And a weird shit situation that we're going to need your help with.
Okay.
Seriously, everybody needs to go hauntedaf.com. Go look up this picture because something's up. First, we have to say hi to our newest patrons, EJ, Nikki Patel, and welcome back to Sean L. Sass.
Yay.
Thank
you.
Yes, a reminder, you can go sometimes if you're like, dude, I can't spare that $5 a month. I get it. And then come back whenever you can. But that's it. Patreon.com/hauntedaf.
And please, while you're at it, remember, leave us a good review because that's, we live and die by our good reviews.
Yeah.
We need a 5-star here and there.
It makes a difference, definitely, to the website.
Absolutely.
But when we go and there's like new positive reviews.
No, I always screenshot them like a dork.
No, but they're so nice.
I'm going to share this because we're awesome.
We've gotten some really good ones lately. So thank you guys.
Absolutely. Thank you. And please, if you can, tell your friends. No, not if you can, tell your friends.
Yes. If you have spooky friends, definitely.
Tell them because they're going to want to listen to Haunted AF for sure. And please also send us your stories. You can write them in because we will gladly read your email. Videos. Just record your audio. We love all that stuff. Please send your stories to hauntedafpodcast@gmail.com.
Okay, so we've got a brand new friend out of Australia.
Love it.
Her name is Alexandra, and she's got a great story for us.
Hi, Julie and Rebecca. My name's Alex. I'm from Melbourne in Australia. I've been listening to your podcast for quite a while now. It definitely helped me get through COVID, so thank you very much. So I grew up in the outer suburbs of Melbourne near a national park. So it was quite far out from the city, yeah, to the point where like kangaroos would actually jump into my backyard. That's not just a myth. So you can imagine it's quite remote and the house was quite big, quite vast as well, like very high ceilings, long staircases and corridors. One day I would have been about like 16 or 17. It was about 7 or 8 at night, but heading towards summer. So it's dusk. It's not, it's not completely dark yet. But I was walking upstairs to my room and I walked past my brother's room, and my brother's room door was completely wide open. The blinds were closed and there were no lights on, which is not unusual. But what was unusual was I could hear this conversation between two people, and it was so loud that I actually stopped in front of my brother's door and asked him what he was doing, talking on the phone with the door wide open and the lights off. The moment that I said that out loud into essentially an empty, dark room, I felt like this whoosh of energy, this wind that came from my brother's room and hit me in the face as I was standing in the corridor. And then something whispered really closely into my right ear. I stood there for a few moments just in shock because I had never experienced anything like that before in my life. And I mean, when I was younger, I never got a good vibe from the room. It kind of wasn't consistent. It was a bit on and off, but that experience just creeped me out and I will never, ever forget it. And I just cannot explain it. So keep up the good work and hope to hear more spooky stories. Thanks.
Thanks, Alex.
But what did it whisper?
I
Does she
know.
Not know?
Alex, what did it whisper? And could you feel it? You
know, like that, like the hot breath, like
yes,
on the back of your neck,
and like the tickle in your ear.
Oh, I don't like that.
Oh
all.
My God! And we need pictures of any kangaroos that ever got into your backyard. Did you know
the cutest dick animal on the planet?
They're such dicks.
Really,
they're
awesome.
Terrifying too, with those big muscly chests. There was a situation in North Texas recently where that woman had a pet kangaroo and it got out. Did you see
I
that?
I do not remember that.
She lived like out on a farm and they were doing construction next door.
And it escaped.
It got scared and it ran off. And so like law enforcement had to get helicopters out and like chase the kangaroo
no
back to her.
Way.
So, but when they interviewed her, she was so happy to have her kangaroo back, but it's like a full size kangaroo.
Yeah, they're like 6 feet tall.
It's big. It's hopping around her house with a giant,
hell no,
with a giant diaper on. Okay. It was literally jumping on her bed with a diaper on. And her husband was sitting there with this kind of like glazed over look, like, what the hell are we going to do about this thing?
No, you know, he's like, how did I get here? Like, how did I let it get this far?
He was like, I'm just trying to be supportive of her.
I love
her. Sorry, so send us kangaroo pictures, Alex.
All right. So this next story comes from Dan, and he says, hey, Rebecca and Julie, I've been enjoying your show so much lately and honestly feel like a freeloader for not sharing my story. So here it is. About 5 years ago, I was spending a lot of my nights with my now ex. We'll call her Jane. Jane lived in a large home in Portland with five other people. Yeah, that's a lot. It was a lively party house, so strange noises and unfamiliar faces were fairly common. It was a three-level home, which Jane shared with, amongst others, a witchy couple upstairs.
A witchy couple?
Yeah. Like, do you really want to share with a witchy couple? Come on.
Get ready.
Jane and I had just gotten back from a late show and went to her room for more intimate activities. Hi. I'll spare you the details.
Thank you.
I wanted them. I'll spare you the details, but at the worst possible moment, I caught something out of the corner of my eye and did a double take. I found myself looking at my reflection in Jane's mirror, but someone's feet and lower legs were hanging just behind me. Scare the right out of you.
So sorry. I am so, so sorry for that.
Definitely scare that erection away.
It like went inside. You think it retracts? I'm so sorry.
It was like concave.
It just went. Oh,
he's never going to write us again.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, Dan. We love your penis.
I love
Stop.
I am. Stop. I'm done.
Okay.
A second passed and it was gone. Then a loud crash came from right above us where the witchy couple lived. We heard panicked footsteps coming down the stairs as we got dressed and found them carrying a small metal trash can with both his arms outstretched. He said, it's fine. We're all good. No worries. Of course he said that as they passed, but there was smoke and an orange glow coming from the bin. Once in the backyard, they sprayed the bucket with water and said some strange chant over it. Like, oh, fire.
Please repair its penis.
They explained that they had been doing some sort of blood magic. When mid-ritual, a box of candles fell from a shelf, which was the crash we had heard, and everything ignited. Were they having a weird sexy time? With chants and stuff?
I don't know. Candles?
I don't know. Then I told them what I had seen in our room, which was right below them. Jane and I decided to stay at my place after that. Well, of course, nothing else happened to me in that house, but there were plenty of stories from other roommates. I never found out what the ritual they were performing was, but I'm pretty sure that that's what started everything. Anyway, that is my ghost story. Keep up the awesome work with the show, ladies. Dan. Whoa.
Yeah.
Bravo, Dan.
Congratulations. That's the first time we've ever heard about blood magic.
Yeah. What? I don't even know what blood magic is. No. But I'm scared to find out.
Yeah. Rituals. No. Mm-mm. Definitely not.
No.
So this next one comes from DeCarlos. I'm a guy, so by default, you know my position on the supernatural.
Yes. I wish you admit it.
Yeah, but something happened when I was a kid that I've never understood. Maybe it was a vivid hallucination, but I've never had one before or after, even after experimenting with LSD and mushrooms.
Oh, wow.
So I've always had trouble sleeping, and when I got scared as a kid, I would sleep with the covers over my head. I did that too. I was scared of the dark, as most kids are, so I had bar lights as night lights, which made it pretty light in my room. You could see pretty much everything. One night, I pulled the covers off of my head because it was hot, and right in front of my face was the disembodied head of a clown, just smiling and rocking back and forth maybe 8 to 12 inches away from me. No,
wait. I don't like this at all.
It didn't move like it was on a neck, though. It moved like the center point was the nose, rocking back and forth and smiling. I immediately pulled the covers back up over my head and eventually fell back to sleep. And do you need a minute? So
I do, because I'm literally like, I'm picturing this whole thing and I'm seeing the nose like being the pinpoint, not moving, and the rest of his face going
just
around.
Just going back and
God,
forth,
that's back creepy as shit.
Yeah. I also remember watching dark shadows about the size of my hand floating from one side of my room to the other. I ran and told my mother that there were UFOs flying through my room since it wasn't uncommon for me to wake her up. She said the next time they come through, tell them to take me with them. And again, that's from DeCarlos. DeCarlos says he hasn't had any experiences like this since. But I'm just going to say, this is not the first time we've gotten stories like this. I mean, the clown is for sure freaky as hell.
I don't even know what I would do.
No,
if I like saw that if I woke up in the middle of the night and there's a fucking clown staring at me, like I'm dead.
Yeah. And I remember we had one very similar to this, a little boy, same thing, had trouble sleeping at night, scared of the dark. And he thought he heard something under his bed. So he just kind of like peeked over. And as he was peeking over, this weird cat monster was sliding out from underneath his bed, looking up at him.
Right.
So when he would slide back onto his bed, it would slide back under the bed. And if he pulled back forward, the cat monster would come back out.
Like
it was mimicking him. Yes. So I think I do honestly think this is some sort of weird hallucination thing that can happen with kids. Yeah. Because
I don't know any other way to explain that.
Yeah. Wow. But you know what it is, Rebecca?
I do know what time it is. Weird shit story here coming from April. This is kind of creepy, kind of spooky, but 100% weird shit. About 3 weeks ago here in Utah, we got a snowstorm that provided the area I live in about a foot of snow in a 12-hour period. I had been outside shoveling this heavy, wet mess, clomping around on my porch in my snow boots. I went inside to warm up when I heard an audible thump on my porch. Turns out the thump was UPS dropping off a package. So I walked back out on my patio, grabbed my package, turned around and walked back in, and just so happened to look down and see a bare footprint in the snow going toward my front door. Now, I know what people will say. It's yours. No, ma'ams. I love that you said no, ma'ams.
No, ma'ams.
Because it's the two of us. No, ma'ams. Barefoot in a foot of snow. No way. What's even weirder is there was only one. You can see in the pic that obviously she's attached for us, the UPS guy's boot prints as well. I looked everywhere and could not find another footprint. I can't explain it. 1,000 on the weird shit meter. Love you, ladies. You make my work days go by faster, April.
Okay, so here's-
let's see this photo because I have not seen it yet.
The picture.
It is a barefoot.
That's a barefoot.
That's the boot.
So there's the boot.
Clearly, what if you just had the one shoe on? Yes, man.
Is it possible?
It is a left. It is a left. It is a left. Right.
Why would he? You know what?
I don't know.
Honestly, April, I think that's it. I think your delivery guy was only wearing one boot for some reason.
It's very strange, but that also still falls under the weird shit category. Because why the hell are you going to wear one boot and not one?
Right. And it looks approximately the same size.
It definitely
does. Which it didn't even occur to me until looking at these right next to each other. It looks like somebody wearing one boot. Oh, I want to know what happened to this delivery driver. There's a really good story here.
What if he got in a fight?
Over
some packages.
Hopefully we just figured your problem or your weird shit situation. But if not, and you happen to, don't you normally have.
I feel like I might have spoiled it.
Yeah, you did. You shit all over it.
I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. No, I think it's kind of great, actually. But yeah, we normally have the same delivery drivers. You know,
yeah. You usually see them on a regular basis.
Yeah. So April, see if you find that guy, you have to ask him and tell him he's like pseudo famous because he was on a podcast.
Yes.
Don't you wish somewhere out there you've done something really weird and people are dissecting it on some weird podcast?
Like my goal is to do weird stuff in public so that I give somebody a great story, like to tell their friends later on. Is that weird?
Yeah, it is. But it's one of the reasons I love you. Also, wanted to share an update from Lisa, and she's the one who shared the four pug weekend story about her husband, Chris.
Love it. That was such a great picture too.
I know the picture of she and her husband together. I sent it to Rebecca in the middle of the night, like when I got it from Lisa, and she was like, I'm just going to cry myself to sleep now. And I'm like, absolutely. So, but if you remember in her story, her husband wasn't allowed to talk about the paranormal or even watch shows like Bewitched or I Dream of Jeannie. His mom absolutely forbade it. So Lisa says, because of your just don't go there philosophy about Ouija boards, I should share that my mother-in-law's dabbling with a board after the death of her own mother is the reason she shut down all talk of the paranormal in their home.
Some crazy shit happened.
Exactly. She says, I've known her for almost 39 years now, and she still won't tell me what she unleashed.
You've got to beg her.
She says, I won the mother-in-law lottery with her. So even though I really want to know, I'll respect her need to keep it to herself. Also, Lisa and Chris would have been celebrating their 34th anniversary last weekend.
Aww.
So big hugs to those guys.
Yeah, so much love. So we also got several stories this week from Kara. They're all awesome. And we shared some of them in this week's Patreon pregame. You can find that at patreon.com/hauntedaf. But we wanted to share this one. Kara says, this happened today, and it's what prompted me to send in my stories. I was dealing with a challenging issue at work, and I needed to clear my head. So I took a shower. I'm a cloud platform engineer and work remotely.
Oh, that's kind of nice. Like,
what is a cloud platform engineer?
I don't know, but I love the idea of things are getting hairy at work. Yeah. I'm going to take a shower. Leave me alone for 30 minutes.
That's a fantastic idea. I put on my favorite podcast, Wink. And set my phone in a niche in my shower where it stays dry and amplifies the sound. I'm right in the middle of washing my hair when I hear two knocks on the door. I ignore it because I'm in the shower and whoever's there, they can just wait. I hear it again and again, ignore it. I heard it a third time, louder. So I said, I'll be out in a minute. A second later, I hear it again and then someone talking. I said, I can't hear you, but I'll be out soon. It happened two more times and I ignored it, thinking it was my daughter back from the zoo. I finally got out of the shower and opened the door, but no one was there. My mom and daughter actually walked in while I was typing this, like an hour after it happened. So it definitely wasn't them. I texted my dad and it wasn't him, but he did come over and went through the whole house for me.
Thanks, Dad.
Good dad right there.
Yeah.
Yep. No one was here. I guess y'all gave me a ghost, so I'm giving y'all my stories. I'll be saging again tonight, just in case. Kara also says, my daughter and I love your podcast. It seems spooky is one of a few topics we can agree on these days. Oh, I love to hear that.
Oh, that's so great.
Yeah. So if you decide to use my stories, please give a shout out to her. Her name is Abigail. She's been begging me to send in my stories. What? Oh, love you, Abigail.
Love you, Abigail. Be nice to your mom.
Yep.
She's like, shut up. Don't tell me that.
Find some common ground.
Yeah, definitely. Okay. And this final story comes from Eric.
Hey, y'all. This is Eric. I recently sent in a Dead Pet of the Week theme song, and Julie asked me if I had any ghost stories to share. So there's a park near my neighborhood that I've been walking my dogs at for about 15 years. It's pretty decent sized. It's got multiple trails running through it, basketball court, a pavilion, a wooded area, and there's a couple graves in the back that date back to the late 1800s. So anyway, I've had multiple weird, unexplainable things happen to me up at this park. Like, I could probably spend 10 or 15 minutes talking about all the weird things I've seen or heard up there. So anyway, one time I was walking my dog through the wooded area and it's almost dark out. It's like that period between dusk and night. And I'm coming up on a picnic table in this wooded area and I see a guy sitting there by himself. So I'm thinking, you know, anyone sitting at a picnic table by themselves in the woods at night is probably up to some questionable activities. Mm-hmm. And so when I have him on my left side, I turn to look. And right when I look at him, the figure stands up and then turns towards me. And it freaked me out because he did it in like two separate movements. You know, a human kind of natural movement would have been to do it all in one motion, like stand and turn. But this almost seemed like a killer in a horror movie, like Mike Myers or something, where he stands up, dun, 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 and then turns to face the victim. You know, it was almost dark out at that point. So all I see is this shadow, like a dark shadow. I can't see any features of the person or thing, whatever it was. And he was huge, like 7 foot tall. I mean, massive. And it's just facing me and not doing anything. So I tell my dog, let's go. And, you know, we like hoof it back to the main trail. And I didn't look back because I was super scared. If I had looked back, it would have been behind me. Another time I was walking down a different trail and all of a sudden I hear two women's voices talking very fast at the same time in like these really hushed, quiet voices, like somewhere between a whisper and like, you know, normal speaking volume. And they're both talking really fast like this, but at the same time, so I can't understand a single word that either of them are saying. Probably took me like 3 seconds for my brain to like process. I'm hearing these voices, but there's nobody else around. This is weird. Like right when I realized that, the voices stop. And then I immediately hear this in my right ear. But that was a long time ago. Like it sounded like somebody was standing right next to me saying that into my ear. along with that, before and after the voice, I heard what I can only describe as this weird, like, phasing kind of vacuum sucking sound. So this is actually what I heard. But that was a long time ago. That's the weirdest thing that's happened to me up there. Like, the shadow guy was the scariest thing, and this was the weirdest. Another thing, like, once I was walking down a trail close to the graves, actually, and just for like a second, maybe like 50 feet in front of me, I see this guy in a black suit, white shirt, hat. You know, he did not look at this era. Like, he was dressed like he was late 1800s, early 1900s, and he looked like mid 50s, and he's just staring directly at me. And it was one of those things where it was just for like a second. So you're wondering if your mind's playing tricks on you. Like, I didn't feel threatened or anything. He was just looking at me. Like, it was one of those things where I was like, did I actually just see that? But I saw his face so clearly that I could have had like a police sketch artist draw it up. After a few years of like having different weird things happen, I just happened to see an article online about haunted places in my town. And to my surprise, this park was on the list. I had never heard anything about it having any kind of reputation of being haunted. I just had like my own weird experiences that I was still trying to look for a rational reason for. But then when I read that article, it's kind of like validating. I was like, wow, maybe there is something to all the weird things that I've been encountering up here. So like what they described is people would drive down the park road at night and see kids in 19th century clothing playing on the basketball court. Or they'd also report seeing people standing over the graves dressed like they're at a funeral. And when I read that part, I immediately thought about the guy that I had seen, because that was close to the graves and he was definitely dressed like he was at a funeral. So everything that happened to me happened within like a 5-year period. And it's probably been like 7 or 8 years since I've had anything odd happen to me up there. And I do wonder if it's because I started telling people about it. Like, at first I never talked about it. And then after I'd had a few encounters, and then especially after I read that article, I would start like, you know, if I'm hanging out with my friends, I'd be like, man, do y'all want to hear a freaky story? I think this park that I walk my dog at's haunted. It seemed like once I started talking about it is when I stopped seeing things. So now that I'm telling it on a podcast, I'll probably never have anything happen to me again. Or it could go the other way and I've angered them and they start following me home and haunting me in my house, in which case I'll have another story to share for a future episode. So thanks, y'all. I love the show and keep up the good work.
Oh, love you, Eric. Do you think that would really, like, if you talk about hauntings, that they go away?
I don't know. That's a great theory.
I love that theory. It also kind of reminded me of the movie The Ring. How, like, if you watch the movie, then you don't die.
Yeah.
And then you pass it on to somebody else.
Right.
Like, so somebody else.
So now he's not haunted anymore, but the people he told the story to, they're especially haunted.
Yep. Just passed it on off.
The thing that struck me isn't as cool. When he's talking about the kids playing on the basketball court, I'm like, are these like old timey kids playing basketball? Because that would be awesome.
I thought that as well. in their weird old timey outfits, right? And shoes and buckles and such. And they're like, oh, hoops.
And they're like killing it at basketball. I love that. Also, Eric, where the fuck are you?
Yeah.
Where is this park?
I kind of want to visit.
We have to. And I mean, obviously they were talking about it on some sort of ghost story thing. Tell us where you are. We need to find the story. We need pictures. We need all of it. So, and then once Eric shares that, we're going to put that in the companion blog. So remember, this is episode 8, season 9.
You know what we forgot?
What?
To tell our own scary stories this week.
Oh my gosh. That's so funny because you and I both had things happen this week.
Both had things happen this week.
Okay.
Who goes first?
I'll go first because mine isn't as cool. Oh. We were staying in Santa Fe.
Yeah.
Did I tell you? I did tell you, didn't I?
Yeah, you did. I had forgotten, though.
We stayed in this really old house in Santa Fe.
Awesome.
And I kept trying to figure out, I'm like, this has got to be, I'd want to say 100 years old, but maybe not. I don't know. But we were very close to Old Town Santa Fe. Mm-hmm. So it was like our fourth night there. And my husband and I both woke up to this horrible crash in our room.
No, you have not told me this story.
Oh, okay.
You were telling me about all your computer being haunted.
Oh, okay. Well, yeah. So we wake up to this crash and both of us are like jumping out of bed, terrified.
I bet.
And he's like, what was that? I'm like, I don't know. And I was closest to the door. So I'm running towards the door to check on the kids. And he says, wait, that was my backpack. So
what?
His backpack with all of his work stuff in it was sitting in a chair where he had set it the night that we got there 4 days prior.
Right.
So it had been sitting there untouched, unmoved, nothing around it. And for some reason, and it was packed with stuff, computer stuff, paperwork, all this stuff. For some reason, it just tipped over and smashed on the floor in the middle of the night.
What the hell?
Yeah. So nothing else happened. But the whole time I was like, this place has got to be haunted. Like it just felt, looked, the whole thing.
Came and kicked over your backpack. That's exactly what happened.
But when we left, we did most, I know Dave and I both had phone issues. And then I was working on last week's podcast the whole way home. And it was like everything on my computer reset. I was struggling with everything. And I even had to delete a few apps and re-download them.
Weird.
Because everything was acting so screwy. So I'm blaming it on our ghost.
It's got to be.
Yeah. But we did find out at the very end of our trip that something was eating our bread. So maybe we just had very, very large mice that knocked over his backpack.
Mouse can knock over probably a 20-pound backpack.
Right. I'm trying to imagine like Pizza Rat or how big would this thing have to be to knock over the backpack?
Maybe a raccoon?
Yeah. But whenever I was, Dave and I both were like, oh, that was weird. He's like, whatever. It was unstable. I was like, it was unstable.
Oh,
it was 4 days later.
Yeah, that doesn't even make sense, Dave. Okay. Come on.
So tell your story. Yours is this is blowing my mind.
Okay. So I got a Snapchat from the dead.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to say his name because he died.
Tragically.
Very tragically. He committed suicide, apparently. And this happened back in August, I believe. And on Sunday, I was messing around with my phone. And all of a sudden, I get a notification on Snapchat. And it's like, ding, new friend on Snapchat. You should be friends. And I look down and I see the name on there. And I'm like, wait a minute. That guy hasn't been here in almost a year. Yeah. He's been gone for a while now. So why the frick am I getting a Snapchat notification from this guy just now joining and a wave?
And a little wave.
Yeah. Creepy, right?
So creepy.
It is so creepy. And I'm like, I've even tried to be logical about it. And I'm like, okay, so maybe it's because I have his phone number still in my phone. Because I did go and look. I was like, let me see if I still have his phone number. Yes, I do have his phone number. But when I go and look on it on Snapchat, it says that we have mutual friends in common. I can't imagine that the person who got his new cell phone number would be
somewhere in that group.
Yes. Yeah. Super weird, right?
That is so weird.
I start asking everybody that knew this person, hey, did you guys get a notification from
right
person who died? And they're like, no, no one else got this notification but me.
Girl,
weird, right?
Well, and the reason it's even weirder is because this is the second time this has happened to you. Remember, there was another
another guy who passed away,
a coworker.
Yeah, in the actual offices of our radio station. And I was at home by myself, of course, listening to some audio, and all of a sudden his audio started playing through my computer.
Yeah.
Which was nuts.
And this was quite a while after he had passed.
Yeah. Oh yeah. 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 Years after he had passed. Yeah. And I'm like, what on earth? Why would he come back 5 years later to blast some audio at me?
It was so
super freaky.
So I think it's this is not going to be a big surprise for anybody, but having worked with Rebecca, I know that everyone she works with has a crush on her. So
I don't think that is true.
I think this is just their way of now it's my time.
You want to date me from beyond the grave? That's an interesting take.
Yeah.
We were too scared in real life.
But
afterlife,
when you sent me that screenshot of that little wave, that is absolutely crazy. Okay, so now we can actually be right?
Yeah, we're at the end of the podcast here. So guys, do not forget, we have companion blogs at hauntedaf.com. Please check them out. That Bigfoot.
Well, it was a Bigfoot.
Yeah. But it was a barefoot print in the snow that you absolutely have to see. Tell us what your theory is on that. That is definitely in the weird shit category. So maybe if you have a story similar to that, send it our way. Also, check out our YouTube channel. Like and subscribe while you're there, and leave us a good review. We love those 5 stars, y'all.
So coming up next week, we finally have an update from my niece. who shared stories back in 2019. Ooh. So do you remember this?
Yes.
Well, by the way, she and her daughter listen all the time.
Oh, I love that.
So hello to Savannah and hi to Charlotte. But she has additions to her Mama Something Just Pinched My Bottom story.
Okay.
Yeah, some pretty creepy ones.
Love it.
In the meantime, keep sending those stories. You got to write them down, record them. In fact, people have been asking, how do you do the voice memo? So if you have an iPhone, there's a voice memo app mm-hmm. on your phone, a little function that's very easy to use. There's also plenty of free voice memo apps that you can download, just play around with them, or just write it all down. Okay. And then send it to hauntedafpodcast@gmail.com so we can use it in season 9 of Haunted AF.